The Metaphys is proud to welcome world-renowned political and economic theorist Michael Albert to deliver his talk, A Vision for 21st Century Leftism. Michael Albert is an organizer, publisher, teacher, and alongside Robin Hanel, the author of the Non-Capitalist Socioeconomic Vision for a Participatory Society. Michael's work is informed not only by an analysis of the establishment, but also a radical critique of the left. Most recently, Michael has published the book No Bosses, A New Economy for a Better World. Of this book, Noam Chomsky has said, a prime goal of Albert's work is to help to reinvigorate that common understanding and to revive the commitment to mutual aid and solidarity. And most important, spell out in some detail how the goals can be realized. Yanis Varoufakis has said, no bosses means that no one can tell anyone what to do from above, not owners or commissars. But how do things get done, comes the inevitable question. To answer it, Michael begins analytically, methodically, by first answering the question, how should things not get done? I'd also like to speak about our co-sponsors for this event. This event is co-sponsored by META, the Center for Post-Capitalist Civilization and Real Utopia. META is a new progressive international art and research center working to break with the dystopic present to imagine the world anew, to grasp our present historical moment so as to help radical progressive movements find the path from the emergent dismal post-capitalism to one worth fighting and living for. Michael is a member of META's advisory board, and we are very grateful at the Metaphys for Sotiris Mitrolexis's agreeing to promote and co-sponsor our event. Sotiris, would you like to speak a bit about META, please?
Yes, well, first of all, I must say that it's very right and proper that an event by a metaphysical society starts with a question of time, as it did. So, a warm welcome from us as well. Thank you very much, Sam, and the Metaphysical Society for the opportunity to contribute to this event with our limited powers. We are indeed an Athens-based, yet we are trying to be an international center for art and politics around the Progressive International, the European Movement DiEM25, and the Greek Mera 25. It's no secret that we are proud of our advisory board, where Michael Albert is very active, and we thank him for that very much. We are now completing a collaboration with Michael on how a post-capitalist vision would look like in a number of its perspectives. So thank you very much again for the opportunity and a warm welcome from us as well. And since I'm currently in England, from this side of the EU border as well.
Thank you very much, Sotiris. Michael, would you like to speak a bit about Real Utopia?
Sure. But maybe I'll do it in the course of the discussion. Real Utopia is an organization that's recently formed, and it relates to the kinds of things that I'm going to be talking about, because it's the Real Utopia is a participatory society, part of which is participatory economics. And so I'll bring it up again in the course of the discussions.
Perfect. So then I'd like to open the floor up to you, Michael, and really look forward to hearing your talk.
Okay, well, first, apparently you're never supposed to apologize to open a talk, but I will apologize. I had this down for 2 o'clock my time, and it's now 1:13 my time. So I obviously got it wrong, and I apologize for that and for this starting a little bit late. Hello to you all. Thank you very much for inviting me to do this. I really appreciate it very much. I should say also, online talks are difficult, and I guess I apologize for that too. When I speak, I'm often very animated. I get very animated. I interact with the audience. It's very difficult to do that online, and so while I wish I could, I won't be doing much of that. I'm also not going to spend much time, at least until we get to the question and answer, rejecting existing social arrangements that we all endure. I'm hoping that the audience doesn't need me to reject racism or sexism or poverty or exploitation or the kind of indignity and denial of influence, not to mention the ecological nightmares and the international violence that typify current institutions of our various societies. I'm simply going to assume we would all like better societies and a better world. If not, well, we can discuss that later. But if we do want better societies and a better world, do we need to say any more than that? Do we need vision? Can we just say that we're for peace and justice and sustainability and dignity and people having say over their own lives and equitable relations? Is it enough to say that and stop, or do we need something more? And I'm not going to spend much time on this, but I do think it's arguably more controversial than that we don't want what we have, and that it is very, very important. I believe that we need more than just those kinds of values and aspirations, that we need institutions, an institutional vision, not a blueprint. We couldn't have a blueprint even if we wanted it. We can't know the future in that kind of detail. But what's more, it's not our province to talk about the future in that kind of detail. You know, people will ask me, well, how many hours will the workday be? I don't know. It's not up to me now. It's not up to you now. It's up to people in future situations with the experiences that they have and the life circumstances that they have and the desires that we have to decide those things and many, many, many other details of the way future societies would look. And different societies may decide differently. Different communities inside of an existing society will decide many things differently. Details are not our purview. However, I do think that we need to have an understanding of the essential features of institutions that will let us make those decisions in the future, that will prepare us and equip us and facilitate our making free decisions about our lives in the future rather than highly constrained decisions. And I think we need that for not just economics. Economics isn't alone important or solely important or even most important. I don't even think that means anything. We need it for polity. We need it for kinship. We need it for culture, for ecology, for international relations, and also for economy. And I don't list economy last because it's more important. I don't believe that. I don't even think it means anything, honestly. I believe we need it all. And there is no point in even thinking about one more than another, one as of a higher priority than another, because to attain a better world and to have it be workable, all these have to be changed to become compatibly constructive of our future freedom. Okay, so what about economics? Well, as described in the introduction, for which Sam, I thank you very much, and Sotiris, hi. My answer to that question is something that's called participatory economics. Some people call it participatory socialism. Some people call it, for shorthand, pericon. I'll probably do all three in the course of the day. So what is it? Well, it's built on five values, because values I do think are important. They're how we gauge our attitude toward things. So if one person proposes institution A and one person proposes institution B, how do you decide which one that you prefer? Well, the answer to me is the consequences of those institutions in terms of their effect on things that we value. So what are the values that I advocate and that I start off with when thinking about how to do a better economy than capitalism? And my answers for that are to realize that economy affects the way people relate to one another. And so it probably behooves us to have a value, something that we aspire to for the way people relate to one another. And for me, the name of that value is solidarity. There's nothing original about that at all. It's been around for ages upon ages. And the idea is that people should be concerned not solely about themselves, not solely about their spouse or their child, but have a generalized solidarity with other people, rather than what we typically have now, which is a kind of a rat race situation in which, to get ahead, each person pits themselves against others, and we lack empathy and we lack solidarity, we lack concern for others. So we want the opposite of that. We want people to have a degree of unification with others. Range of options is another thing that an economy affects. And for that, my preferred value, I just like to use the word diversity. Again, I don't think it's controversial. All other things equal, we would rather have a diverse, rich situation than a homogenized situation. But why? Well, actually, I think one of the reasons is because we don't live forever. That is to say, I can get pleasure out of the fact that other people do things that I have neither time nor means nor capability to do. We can benefit from the diverse richness of human attainments and appreciating them. And another reason is because you don't want to homogenize down to a single approach in case that approach is wrong. You want to have other things on the table, other possibilities to explore in case something goes wrong with what you desire. I don't think this is controversial either, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it. But if it is controversial, bring it up when we have discussion. The next one is more controversial. An economy affects what we might call the distribution of income. It affects how much of the social product, the stuff that's produced each year, how much of that goes to you, how much goes to me, how much goes to each other person, what's our income? And the word that I use for this, I use the word solidarity and diversity. For this, I use the word equity, but I have a particular meaning. And it's different from what some other people might say is equitable. For me, what's equitable is that people should get income for how long they work, for how hard they work, and for the onerousness of the conditions under which they work, as long as they produce something socially valued. So if what I produce is socially valued, I get more income if I work at it longer, if I work at it harder, or if I work under worse conditions, and the opposite. If I work less, I get less income. If I work less hard, I get less income. If I work under better conditions, I get less income. Now, you'll notice that that's almost the opposite of what we have now. And the reason for that is because, even though I said I won't spend a lot of time on what we have now, maybe I'll spend a little. Now what we have is three possible ways of remunerating other than what I just described. One is for property. So Bezos makes billions, you know, in the time that, you know, you brush your teeth. And he makes huge sums of money in very short duration and with very little effort and under the absolute best conditions imaginable. So it has nothing to do with what I'm saying should be remunerated. Instead, it's remunerating property. So what I'm talking about rules that out. But another possibility is to get more because you have more bargaining power. That's typically the dynamic of a market system. In a market system, buyers and sellers confront each other. They try to fleece each other for one to do better, the other does worse. And the mediator of who does better and who does worse is bargaining power. If you're in a racist society, the subordinate racial group has less bargaining power. It's going to have less income. In a sexist society, the gender that's subordinate women are going to have less income. If you have, say, a labor union or not a labor union, well, you're going to do better with the labor union because it's going to increase your bargaining power. And if the last, and I think we can rule those out pretty straightforwardly. We don't want a thug's economy. We don't want an economy where you get what you can take. That's bargaining power. We don't want an economy where you get a fortune because you happen to own property. We're going to rule that out. What else is there other than what I suggested, equitable remuneration? Well, there's one other possibility, broadly speaking, and that's that instead of rewarding property or power, we can reward output. And the idea here is that you make more dependent on what you personally produce by your efforts. So if you produce more output or more valued output, you make more income and less. And there are a lot of socialists who believe in this norm. They believe that we should remunerate people for essentially for the value of the output that they produce. I don't believe that. And the reason why I don't believe that is because the value of your output that you produce is not only a function of, it's partly a function of how long you work, how hard you work, and not so much the onerousness of the conditions under which you work. But it's also a function of basically your genetic endowment, whether or not you're lucky enough to be using better tools than somebody else, whether or not your workmates happen to be better than somebody else's workmates, what you happen to be producing. In other words, all kinds of luck, luck in the genetic lottery, right? If I am born with Chomsky's brain, or I apologize, I don't know English football players or Scottish football players in the United Kingdom, but you probably know who LeBron James is. If I'm born with LeBron James's genetics, I can produce much more that people value. People like watching LeBron James. So when I have this discussion with socialists, I often say to them, is LeBron James paid too much or too little? And most socialists who advocate remunerating for output say he's paid way too much, way, way too much. And I say, no, by your norm, he's paid too little. LeBron James gets less income than the value of what he produces. A lot of it goes to Nike or to the owners of the basketball team, and now it's the Los Angeles Lakers, or to the TV networks. He doesn't have enough bargaining power to take all of it. But you think he should get even more if you believe in that norm. And of course, the socialists realize at that point that they don't believe in that norm. They don't think that that's appropriate. And neither do I. So the norm that I favor is equitable remuneration for how long you work, how hard you work, and the onerousness of the conditions under which you work, as long as what you're doing is socially valued. All right. Who gets to make decisions and with what influence? That's another thing that economics profoundly affects. What do we want for that? Well, some people might say the smartest people or the best decision makers decide. Somebody else might say, well, I want democracy. I want one person, one vote, majority rule. And I don't agree with either of those things. What I want is what I call self-management. And the idea here is, and again, this is not particularly original. Maybe some of the details are, but not in the broad. The idea is that a person should have influence over decisions in proportion to the degree they're affected. So imagine that you're all sitting in a workplace right now. You're all workers in the workplace, you're employees in the workplace, and you're getting up in the morning and deciding whether or not to wear a red shirt or a blue shirt. You don't think that there should be a decision made by majority rule of all your workmates. You make that decision, and you make it like Stalin. You make it alone, singularly, like a dictator, and that's appropriate. But there are other decisions. Deciding whether or not you should bring a radio with you and play it during the workday that would affect other people. And you don't think you should make those decisions alone. And the idea here that comes to the fore is that it's appropriate for people to have a say in what affects them. And indeed, it's appropriate to have a say sort of in proportionate to the degree that you are affected. And that should be true for everyone. And that's the idea of self-management. So, it isn't the case that in this group of people, let's say there's somebody who's really who's a chemist, and there's a decision whether or not to paint the walls, and there's a choice between various brands of paint, and one of them has lead in it. And the state of knowledge at the time is that such that none of you really know that lead paint is unhealthy except the chemist. Does that mean the chemist should make the decision? No, it means the group should consult the chemist, learn about the circumstances because they're that important, and then people should have a say in proportion to the degree they're affected. Maybe in that case, it would be one person, one vote, majority rule. The point is the algorithm by which you count up votes and the procedures that you use to deliberate and to exchange information, those are all what we might call tactics. A majority rule isn't a principle. Neither is consensus. These are things which are useful in some circumstances and not in others. And what determines that? Well, in my opinion, not everybody agrees, of course, what determines that is what is best for attaining a situation of self-management. Okay, and there's one last value. And the last value is one that some people in here will be upset by on first hearing it, but hopefully not later. It's efficiency. You, in the economy, you want to produce stuff to meet needs and develop potentials. Okay. But what does the word efficient mean? Well, the reason why it makes some of us nervous a lot of the time, or even nauseous a lot of the time, is because in the hands of the people who run our society, efficiency seems to mean profitability. It seems to mean the most for them, regardless. And there's a reason why the word means that to them. What the word really means is accomplishing what you desire to do without wasting things that you value. That's efficient. It's not efficient to accomplish what you want, but in the act of doing so, to waste a lot of stuff. And it's not efficient to not accomplish what you want, no matter how cautious you are about waste. So you want to accomplish your ends and not waste things you value. So for Jeff Bezos, who runs Amazon and owns it, what does he want to accomplish? Profits for Jeff Bezos. What does he value? Nothing that is not central to his profitability, to his making profits. So he doesn't care about the health of his workers. He doesn't care that they have to drive around in his trucks and piss in a bottle because they're on such a strict schedule. He doesn't care about any of that. So the fact that that happens is not a case of him wasting something. He's not wasting their human potentials because he doesn't value their human potential, right? So that doesn't count. What counts is achieving profitability and actually maintaining the conditions by which he achieves profitability. But what about us? For us, efficiency means we want to meet needs and develop potentials without wasting things we value. It would not be desirable for, let's say, this is our workplace. Again, you're all employees in a workplace. And let's say you want to produce bicycles to fill a social need for bicycles. But in the act of doing it, you're doing it in such a clumsy way that you're wasting a lot of resources. That would be inefficient because you'd be wasting something you value, resources, even though you were building the bicycles. And to not build the bicycles would also be inefficient. So we value efficiency and we should value it, but we should be very careful not to get sucked into meaning by efficiency, attaining profits while destroying humans. Okay, so with those ends or those values in place, we can think about what would institutions to achieve those values look like? What would it require? What would we need to accomplish those aims? That's what I think thinking about vision is. And so, in fact, if this was a discussion of kinship vision, or of cultural and community vision, or of political vision, the same logic would apply, right? We would have values in those domains, and we would want to define institutions, not a blueprint, but the critically important institutions that would be necessary for us to fulfill those values. And I think that undertaking should occur. But let's continue for now with economics. Okay, so the first thing, and I'll do it in sort of the order, I guess you could say, in which it occurred to the people who did this the first time. So we're sort of following the path that we once followed. So the first thing is, we already knew because we were socialists that we didn't want private ownership of the means of production. All right, why not? Because if you have private ownership, it means that one person or a small group of people are making the decisions, and there goes self-management. They're having gigantic incomes, and there goes equity. They're squashing diversity because it threatens their power, and solidarity disappears in the class struggle. So you don't want private ownership. Okay, but if you get rid of private ownership, well, what's the next step? Private ownership, not of shirts, by the way, not of your shoes or your clothes, or private ownership of means of production, private ownership of the stuff with which humanity produces the social product that we all use, right? That's the stuff that we don't want to be privately owned: workplaces, tools, equipment, resources, and so on. Okay, but if you get rid of that, well, it raises a new question. What do you do with all that stuff? What do you do with the accumulated wisdom in technologies? What do you do with resources? What do you do with the venues that are the the buildings in which things are made and the equipment with which they're made. Well, I think the answer to that is if nobody's going to own it, you can think of it as, okay, that's the end of the discussion. Nobody owns it. Or you can think of it as, and it amounts to the same thing, but it's easier to get, I think. You can think of it as part of a productive commons. So all that stuff that was once owned as means of production is now a productive commons, which society essentially is borrowing from when it utilizes a workplace, or a set of workers are borrowing from when they have a workplace and they produce stuff. And we'll see where that comes from a little bit later, or what that means a little bit later. But having gotten rid of the owners, we've also done something else, which is a big deal. The owners are no longer making all the decisions. So in talking about this workplace, all of you as employees of a workplace, and I'll be the bad guy, if I was the owner before, I was telling you what to do. Actually, I was telling you what to do with a degree of authority and control that dictators only dream of in the political sphere. I was telling you when you could go to the bathroom. I was telling you what speed you had to operate at. I was telling you when you had to come and go. I was telling you how, et cetera, et cetera. A tremendous control. But we just got rid of that. We just got rid of me as the private owner, or a set of private owners in some cases. So now we have to do something about decision making, because we no longer have the decision maker. So having done that, if we want self-management, it means we want all the workers to be able to participate in decision making in proportion to the degree they're affected. So that means we need a venue, a mechanism for workers to all express their desires, deliberate the issues, and arrive at a conclusion. And we call that the Workers' Council. And we also do that for consumption, collective consumption, like of a neighborhood. So we have consumers' councils. So there's workers' and consumers' councils that are self-managing, that use a self-managing mode of decision-making. And we have to be a little careful about that. We'll come to a little later. It doesn't mean what some people think it means. Some people think it means, well, the Workers' Council just decides what to do with the workplace. That's that. Then they do it. And there's, you know, it's their issue. They do it. They decide it. It doesn't mean that. Because what happens at the workplace affects other people. And therefore, those other people need a share of the say. And that's a task that will arrive in a little while. Okay, but we now have a productive commons, workers and consumers self-managing councils. We still have a problem. If the workers are to make good decisions, and we want good decisions, the workers have to be in position to do that. They have to have a degree of knowledge of the circumstances. They have to have a degree of confidence. I'm going to just ignore whatever's happening to the lights, unless somebody tells me otherwise. They have to have a degree of confidence. They have to have skills and talents and capacities that are suited to making decisions. They don't all have to be the chemist, remember that example, but they have to be able to hear what people who do have special knowledge have to say, and they have to be able to deliberate and to arrive at a conclusion. And if you look at most workplaces now, and you ask, not can the managers do that, they can, they have a warped set of priorities, but they can do that. Not can the, you know, the CEO and so on do that, but can the people on the assembly line do that? And can the people who, and you got to be a little skeptical here. And the reason you got to be a little skeptical is different from why most people are skeptical. Most people are skeptical for reasons we'll come to in a minute, which is that they think working people are idiots and incompetent. But no, that's not the reason. The reason is a lack of knowledge and information and access to levers of decision-making and connections to others. Why is that the case? Well, there's a division of labor in current economic institutions and current workplaces, not only in the United States, but also in countries that call themselves socialists. And this was true also in the past in countries that called themselves socialists. The division of labor is essentially the same, and it looks like this. A set of jobs exists. it can be seen as having two kinds of work. One kind of work is a job that is composed of tasks, each of which is broadly empowering. The tasks in the jobs are of such a character that when you do them, the impact on you is empowering. You get more information, you get a certain degree of confidence, you get access to levers of decision making, you get connections to other people and social skills associated with making decisions and deliberating and so on. Another kind of job is disempowering. The second kind of job is like, for instance, assembly line work. It's work whose characteristics actually de-skill the worker, diminish the worker's overall knowledge of the workplace, hide information, create disconnection with other people, not connection, diminish confidence. And what you get then is a situation where about 20%, and that's what the numbers are, about 20% are in empowering situations and 80% are not. And our problem is that we want decisions in our workplace to be made by what? By the whole workforce. So we don't want 20% of the workforce to be making the decisions and 80% to be following their orders. That's not self-management. That's a class division. That's a division of what I want to call the coordinator class, the empowered sector of the workforce, above the working class, the disempowered sector of the workforce. That's not self-management. It's not solidarity. There'll be no solidarity between those groups, and there isn't in contemporary society. It's not, and so on. So what do you do if you want to get rid of that? And that was the next question that we confronted. Get rid of private ownership because it destroys the values we hold dear. Having gotten rid of private ownership, have the stuff that was privately owned now in a productive commons. Having done that, we need decision makers. It's workers in their workers' council. Having done that, we need the decisions to be good. The workers have to be prepared and able and confident and empowered. And so we have to change the division of labor. We have to make it the case that we still have jobs, and jobs are still a combination of tasks. It isn't that everybody does everything, which is ludicrous. It's impossible. But it is that each person does an array of tasks that compose their job such that the empowerment effects for that job, for that person, are like the empowerment effects, different job, of a different job for another person, and so on and so forth. So that basically everybody is in an economic situation, in the division of labor, in the act of producing things, and so on, that is comparably empowering to the situation of others. And so we have what we call balanced job complexes. And that's another element of or feature of participatory economics. Now, I want to say a little bit more about this, partly because the issue here, I think, is an issue of class division and overcoming it. And some of you will probably have some Marxist background. It doesn't really matter. You could even have mainstream background. And the general consensus is there are owners and there are workers. And what is being said here is that, yes, ownership relations yield that difference. A set of people who own the means of production on the one hand, and a set of people who own only their own labor power and sell it on the other hand, workers and owners. However, the reality of current society and society for a long time is that, in my opinion at least, there aren't two core classes, two critically important classes. There are three. There's owners, there's workers, and in between, there's a coordinator class, an empowered class of employees who have much greater power and influence and say, and also income, than the working class proper. And so, you can get rid of private owners, but still have a dominant class. You can get rid of private owners, as say in the Soviet Union, or in the old Soviet Union, or in the old China, and still have a group, about 20% of the population, who is a ruling class above about 80% of the population, who's a working class. All right, so good, so be it, but are we overlooking a severe problem? Suppose Margaret Thatcher was here, Margaret Thatcher famous for there is no alternative. If she was here, she would have been outraged already, but at this point she'd be apoplectic. She would have been outraged at getting rid of private ownership because she would have said, those are the people who take initiative. Those are the people who have the wherewithal to make things happen. Okay, I'm going to assume that we understand that that's just a rationalization, that it isn't the case. But we can discuss that in the discussion if you want to, of course. She would also have been upset about self-managed councils. And in this case, it would have been because she would have said, what are you talking about? If everybody makes decisions, instead of the best decision makers making decisions, we'll get crummy decisions. And our answer was, no, we consult experts, but we have everybody make decisions because everybody has a right and an ability and brings also their own understanding of the implications of the decisions, and thus we get better decisions. Okay, that might be controversial for some people, but I think it's valid. And I want to skip to her third criticism, where I'll spend a little more time on it. And her third criticism would be of balanced job complexes. And she would say, Michael, you're out of your mind. It seems to me, Margaret would say to me, that you're saying that, for example, in a hospital, the brain surgeon should not do just brain surgery, because that's highly empowering, but, and let's assume it is, but should do, instead of just that highly empowering thing, also other things like maybe cleaning bedpans or custodial work or whatever in the hospital. Each place has their own, you know, has its own kinds of jobs. And she would say, you're actually saying that, and that's insane. We would lose all of that surgery. And so for your honorable pie in the sky, no classes aim, we would have given up output, in this case, surgery, and we'd all be sick. That's absurd. What's the answer to that? First off, it's not an unfamiliar argument. And it takes, it has occurred historically under, around a number of issues. So one way to understand this argument and to get at the answer is to think back 50 years and to imagine, okay, we'll use surgeons as an example, to imagine that all the surgeons in the society, all the brain surgeons, were in a big stadium. It's a big enough stadium to hold them all. And so we're looking around in that stadium and we see something stark. And I hope you all can sort of grok in your own minds what it is we see. We see that almost everybody in the stadium, we'll make it in the United States now for the sake of discussion, is white. And we also see that almost everybody in the stadium is male. The surgeons are white and male. And if we were to ask them, first of all, why is there that random black person? They would say, oh, it's an accident of genetic whatever. But they would say it has nothing to do with the real issue here, which is the overall balance. And if we ask them, well, why are you all men? Why are you all white? They would say, well, because we're able to be surgeons. And women and blacks are not able to be surgeons. They're just incapable of being surgeons. They aren't. And that's what Thatcher would say under those circumstances. And of course, we know that, well, anybody at the time who was in touch with reality, you knew that that was nonsense. But now we know that it's nonsense because 51% of the people in medical school in the United States are women. And actually, I think the percentage of blacks is over the percentage of blacks in the population also. So we know it's false. But what was the explanation? If you had asked the surgeons, they would have told you that they can't do it. If you had asked women and blacks outside the stadium 50 years ago, or let's make it 60 years ago, many of them would have said the same thing. And many of the others who didn't say it would have thought it at some deep down level. Of course, it was wrong. It wasn't the case. What was the case? What was the case was that those two constituencies, endured life circumstances from birth on through, you know, right up through growing up, right into schooling, and then into the jobs that they occupied, that robbed them of dignity, robbed them of efficacy, robbed them of knowledge, robbed them of capacity, that stifled their capabilities. So what you had was that, yes, at a particular moment in time, there wasn't a lot of women or Blacks who could be surgeons, but it was because of a set of social institutions that made them lack the background and the training and the confidence and so on and so forth. All right, so now come forward to the present. I think it's analogous. I think that the reason why 80% of the population that's doing disempowering work, it can be said to be incapable of doing empowering work, is analogous. It isn't because they're genetically lacking something that is necessary in order to be a full participant in social life. That's not the reason. The reason is because they endure a class-divided system, which prepares some people to endure boredom and take orders, and other people to be the masters of the universe. And the impact of that on them leads to the situation. So when Thatcher says that the surgeon not doing surgery all the time, but instead cleaning bedpans and so on to have a balanced job complex, and she says, we'll lose the amount of surgery that surgeon could have done instead of cleaning bedpans, she's correct. But when she says, we'll lose that for all of our current surgeons, and that's it, we'll have lost all that surgery, and we'll have lost all that engineering, and we'll have lost all that managing, and we'll have lost, et cetera, for various kinds of empowering work, then she's wrong. And the reason she's wrong is because the 80% of the population that is denied the circumstances, the training, the confidence, the material well-being to potentially do empowered work would have all of that, and would be able to more than replace what we were taking away. So the net result would be that the liberation of the capacities of 80% would in fact mean a far more productive overall workforce, not a less productive one, as Thatcher would worry. And so that's the answer to that criticism of balanced job complexes. Of course, there's another criticism of balanced job complexes, which is true. That is the criticism by somebody who would be in an empowered job saying, well, I'm going to have to do some disempowering work and I don't like that. Well, that's true. All right. That's not dissimilar to the Bezos saying, I don't like you're getting rid of private ownership because I'll lose all my privately owned wealth. He's right. He will. Attaining a just society does involve some degree of loss for some sectors and at times. But honestly, on balance, the coordinator class, the people who have a monopoly on empowering circumstances and work, will lose that monopoly. They will do balanced jobs, and they will have equitable income. But they will also gain a lot. They won't be hated by 80% of the population. They won't have to defend themselves against that. They won't have to contort themselves or distort themselves to justify their advantages, which are not earned, and so on and so forth. It's a bigger discussion. In any case, at this point, we have our balanced job complexes with our self-managed councils and our productive commons, and it comes time for remuneration. And now we need that norm that I said was a value. And it turns out that that's sort of like an institutional piece of participatory economics also. You can't have a workforce where everybody is comparably empowered and everybody is doing a balanced job, and we pay unfairly. Some people get so you have to have sort of a fair payment mechanism And I think what a fair payment mechanism is, maybe this will be debated down the road and changed or something, I don't think so, is that people get more for working longer or harder or under worse conditions. And so that's what we would have. So in a sense, you could think of it as if we all worked in this good economy, an average duration, intensity, and onerousness, and we were all doing socially valued labor, and that remains to be discussed. We were all doing socially valued labor, then we'd all earn the same income. But in fact, some of us are going to want to work longer because we value the extra income more than we value the leisure. And some of us, you know, will work less long than average because we value the leisure more than we value the income. And people are free to do that. So that's where the differences would arise, and it would be a function of our desires. Okay, so no, we've now gotten to the point where we have these first four components of participatory economics, and there's something left. And it's sort of a big thing, and it's a more complicated thing. And how do we get at what it is? Well, again, let's consider us a workplace. And we're all employees, and we have self-management, and we have our workers' council. And let's say we produce bicycles. So we're getting together to decide how many bicycles we should produce. And how do we do that? How do we know how many bicycles we should produce? Do we just consult our own taste for how long we'd like to work, you know, for our own circumstances? What if nobody wants bicycles? Or what if people want a lot more bicycles than that would be? Or what if other people are affected? What if in making the bicycles, there's a certain amount of pollution and it affects people? If we're going to make responsible decisions, which respects other people's self-management, just like we want them to respect ours, something has to convey to us information throughout the economy. Something has to tell us information which lets us accommodate or bend to the will of, both are going on, other constituencies. We can't overproduce bicycles just because we want to work a lot of hours, because it's waste, it's inefficient. And not only that, it violates other people's self-management. It's wasting stuff that they want, and they don't want the bicycles. I hope this is clear. Allocation is about the connection between, let's call it, workplaces and other workplaces, and workplaces and consumers. And the economic activity of the society has to be a kind of a mesh. It's essential that what's produced is desired and is consumed. And it's essential that what's desired to be consumed is produced. And it's essential that the deciding of how much and in what ways takes into account the effect on all of the people, thus the ecological effects, the social effects, the personal effects. And so we need an allocation system. Well, one way that this is done in societies is to have central planning, which means that you have some people who basically look at everything in society and look at all that's going on and look at the factories and look at the productive potentials and sit down, literally, and figure out what they think the plan should be. And it's probably got a lot of peculiarities, so they show it to some other people and they get feedback and they refine it and maybe they do that again. And then they send it to all the workplaces and the consumers, and basically, it's society's economic plan, and the rest have to obey and follow it. Well, we don't want that because we believe in self-management, and also because those planners will turn out to be coordinator class. It will reintroduce the coordinator class, working class division, including in units, but maybe we can just talk about that in discussion. What about markets? Well, markets is no good also, because in markets, first of all, you have a buyer and a seller. And so you have a seller of a car and a buyer of a car. And the buyer and the seller are negotiating, and given their respective bargaining power and the competitive dynamics in the market system, they arrive at a price and they make the transaction. The trouble is that the people who are going to breathe the pollution from the car are not involved in the discussion. So even if we didn't have owners, but we had markets, still, they would not be conveying the correct information to people. They would not be allowing people to make responsible decisions because they exclude all kinds of effects of the transaction from the deliberations over whether or not to do the transaction and how to do the transaction. So that's one problem. Another problem is that they violate solidarity. They create a war of each against all. Now, these things are actually not controversial. Mainstream economists will agree with the things I'm saying now. It's just that they'll say, well, there's no better alternative, Margaret Thatcher again. But they're not going to deny the ills of the system. The markets produce a kind of warped individualism, a kind of anti-solidaritas individualism in which one is out for self and that's it. Markets violate the ecology. Markets create a drive to accumulate a surplus in competition. These are longer discussions, but in any case, the point is that the advocates of participatory economics find markets to be way beyond abhorrent. They find them to be one of the worst artifacts of human creativity in all of human history, one of the most destructive and debilitating things about social life. And so we're stuck with having to replace markets and central planning. And what is proposed is called participatory planning. It's the hardest thing to describe, quickly in a talk, but I'll sort of try and do it. We have workers' councils, we have consumers' councils and individual consumers, and we are looking for a mediation between all of those, which is conveying the necessary information and therefore arriving at good outcomes. And what the essence of what participatory planning is, not some of the details which are essential to its functioning properly, et cetera. But the essence of it is we are a workforce. You all are the employees of our workforce. You have balanced jobs. You get equitable income and you make bicycles again. And so you put forward a proposal for the coming year for bicycles. How do you do that? Well, you know how many were produced last year and you have pretty good estimates and pretty good conception of whether or not there's a change in taste for bicycles. And so you put forward a proposal. And individuals put forward their proposals for bicycles. Maybe there's a community buying of bicycles like there would be for, say, a pool for a community, but whatever. So there's a proposal for the consumption of bicycles, which is a collective product of everybody. There's a proposal for the production of bicycles, which is a summing of your workplaces proposal and other workplaces. And there's a mismatch at the outset. It's very likely that the demand is higher than the supply, but it's possible that the reverse is the case. And what participatory planning involves is no center, no authority, and no competition. It involves a kind of a sequential negotiation in which we, our workplace, gets the feedback of what the first round of the planning revealed about people's current tastes and desires, and we modify our proposal in light of that. And the consumers are doing the same thing. And in the process of that, through a series of iterations, the supply of various things is coming into close enough accord with the demand of various things to arrive at a plan. And what's claimed for this process, which has some more components, but what's claimed for it is that it arrives at a plan. The plan is feasible. The plan addresses stated needs and desires. The plan involves workers and consumers each impacting the flow of the discussion and the arrival at a decision in proportion, roughly, as they're affected. It takes into account ecological implications as well as personal and social implications. And so it's a good result. And unlike, say, markets or central planning, it doesn't conflict with our other features. It doesn't conflict with having a productive commons or having equitable remuneration or having balanced job complexes. It supports them. It facilitates them. So you have an economic model, I suppose you could call it, or a vision, which isn't everything about an economy, but it's these main institutional features. And what the advocates of participatory economics claim is that it delivers the values that we desire. It delivers self-management, equity, diversity, solidarity. It actually is an economy in which to get ahead, for me to get ahead, others have to get ahead. For you to get ahead, others have to get ahead. You don't get ahead at somebody else's disadvantage. People benefit in accord with the benefit of all. And so solidarity is produced. And it's classless. It doesn't have a coordinator class. It doesn't have a capitalist class. It just has working people. And working people are all in this together, so to speak. And so I guess what I would say, I want to get to discussion. I guess what I would say is, based on this talk, nobody should be convinced of any of this. It's a big mouthful. So I don't think you should be convinced based on a talk, but this is what I would hope for, that the talk plus the discussion would cause you to entertain the possibility, that's sufficient, entertain the possibility that there's something called participatory economics that would have those attributes that I described, that would be equitable, that wouldn't generate a rat race, that would, et cetera, and that would work. Because if it's a possibility, then it seems to me that it would make sense to want to discover, okay, what do I think of it in more detail? What do I think of it if I spend more time looking into it, right? Why? Because I want it to be true, basically. I don't want to advocate it if it's not, but I want it to be true. And I want it, and if it isn't true, but it's in the ballpark, I want to refine it. I want to make it true. I want to make it the case that there is an economic vision that can organize our aspirations and our choices in the short run and be an alternative to capitalist economics. And so that would make sense to me. And if you came to that conclusion, then I will do a shameless plug. It would make sense to get the book No Bosses. If I could send it to you all, I would. That you get the book No Bosses, read it, decide for yourself what you think. In a more calm and relaxed situation where the thing is more fully presented. It seems to me that that would make sense. And then if we agree, we can share that vision with others. And if we don't, not. And let me just say, since I, in the very beginning, RU was mentioned, Real Utopia. Real Utopia at realutopia.org is an organization just beginning of people who advocate not only participatory economics or who are really interested in developing an awareness of participatory economics, but also participatory kinship, participatory culture, participatory polity. And if you want to ask about them, you can. And I'm happy to comment on some of that too. And it's an organization that's trying to be a repository of people further evaluating these ideas, further advocating and proposing them in hopes of arriving at a shared vision to guide a new kind of shared practice. We haven't talked about what the differences would be for strategy and for practice, but we can do that in the discussion too. So I guess I'll stop there and hopefully we can have a fruitful discussion. I'm happy to do it as long as you wish to do it.
Thank you very much, Michael. So if people in the lecture hall would like to raise their hand, I can bring this microphone over to let you ask your question. And if people on Zoom would like to either submit their question via web chat or unmute themselves and begin speaking, I'm sure we'll figure it out. The first question, I might as well kick it off. Michael, thanks again for your talk. It seems to me that your analysis of the corporate division of labor could provide insight into the movements on the right which have risen in the past few years, which are often described as populist and anti-expert, and seem to have a hatred of the left. I think you could see them in the election of Trump, maybe Brexit, and maybe most recently COVID denial. I'm wondering what you think about this and whether you agree. Or...
Yeah, I quite agree. The first time I encountered this was a long time ago in the United States. A guy named Spiro Agnew was the vice president. And he would talk about, I think he called it bullet-headed liberals and intellectuals. And what he was doing was he was trying to organize basically working people to support positions that were horribly harmful for them on the basis that he was attacking what they in fact had class consciousness toward disliking, which was doctors, lawyers, engineers, managers, and so on. And he was pretty good at it. He wasn't as good at it as Trump years later. There haven't been so many years of it. So your question is basically, in my mind, why does Donald Trump, or why was Donald Trump a billionaire, and there are others around the world who are emulating the exact same strategy, able to galvanize support from even one working person, much less millions? Right? How is that possible? How can, and a lot of people on the left say, well, it's because working people are so stupid. It's that attitude that made it possible. It's that working people have experienced in the United States, Democrats, liberals, Republicans, and just the day-to-day existence subordinate to people with a whole lot of stature, higher income, more say, more training and education. And they resist it. The second time I encountered this, I'm going to answer this at some length because I do think it's fundamentally important. I was teaching in prison. And I don't know why, but I was able to do whatever I wanted. And so I had a class with a whole lot of convicts in the class with all kinds of crimes, but it was a significant security prison. And so they were in there for pretty serious crimes in most cases. It wasn't just drug offenses. And I was teaching about a course on capitalism and socialism. And when I was trying to teach about capitalism, I would talk about owners and their influence and so on and so forth. And there would be discussion. And there was no passion. You know, you could just feel it. It wasn't as if the audience was aroused and exhibiting essentially class anger, class conscious anger of these wealthy capitalists. And then we talked about the coordinator class and everything went berserk. All of a sudden there was incredible passion. You could feel the class hatred, the class anger at this other class. Now, how could that be? Because while I do think there's a class difference between coordinators and workers, it's certainly not anything like the class division between owners and workers in terms of the impact on their lives. And the answer, I think, is working people never meet an owner. Working people have never experienced personal denigration at the hands of an owner because they never encounter an owner. They never come anywhere as near an owner. Most of you have probably never interacted personally with people in the 2%. Maybe some of you have, maybe some of you have parents, you know, but working people, that is people in disempowering jobs, generally haven't. But they've all interacted often with coordinator class. And they all, and the way, and I was learning at this point, and they would describe it to me like this. I would say, how do you know? And they would say, Michael, you walk down the street and you can tell from the way people walk. You can tell from the assumption that you'll go around them and they won't go around you. You can tell from what people are wearing. You can all the ways that we understand this. And so if you ask me why is Trump able to galvanize a certain amount of support, it's not because because people are looking at his words and are outright racist, are looking at his words and I love you, Donald. Okay, fine. But there's a significant proportion of people who are turning to these guys, and they're turning to them as a faint hope that maybe they will make things different in a way that will be beneficial. And that is a manifestation of class consciousness of a sort. So yes, a lot of people were against Hillary because she was a woman. But I think that the bigger dynamic was that Hillary just exuded coordinator class paternalistic arrogance. Whereas Donald Trump looked like somebody you could go have a beer with. That's how Bush won also. And then Biden, you know, less than Hillary, but still the same thing. And so, yes, I do think it. That's one sense in which it's true, that there's a problem on the left that has contributed to this problem in society. And there's another sense, which is, I don't know how long I should go on about this, but there's another sense in which it's true, which is that, well, I've been a left revolutionary advocate of a new economy and a new society since 1967, I guess. So a long time. And in that time, I have to say, me and my cohorts have failed at many things. We've succeeded at some things, but we've failed at many things. And one of the things that we failed at was not getting this awareness of a third class and of the third class's relations and of the need to change our organizations and our organizing in light of this, to change the way we talk, the way we write in light of this. All too often, the left is appealing to some kind of intelligentsia or supposed intelligentsia instead of using normal words that normal people can relate to. And that has nothing to do with intelligence. That just happens to do with the stored up, you know, vocabulary of people. And yet we orient toward the stored up vocabulary of highly educated people, coordinator class. And I could go on and on, but it ought to be evident, and obviously it was to you, given the question, that the problem is not their deplorable. The problem is a set of institutions which create certain kinds of dynamics and certain kinds of absent information and knowledge, and a movement which did not sufficiently address it and needs to do so. It would be like if we had not had anti-racist movements for the last 50 years that really addressed racial issues, right? We'd be where we were. We're actually a lot further along. A lot of people now don't realize it, but the situation of women and blacks, say, has vastly improved, albeit there's more to go. But the situation of working people, not so much. To the extent it's improved because of their own efforts and their own unions and organizations. I think the answer to your question is yes. The three-class structure has a lot to do with the ability of right-wing populism to win over a certain number of working people because they dislike, even hate, the arrogance of the left. I'm going to give one more example. The No Nukes movement. Some of you may remember there was a gigantic No Nukes movement back, I guess, decades ago. Very large. There were demonstrations of 500,000 people in New York. There were demonstrations at nuclear reactors, which, you know, knocked down fences and ran into the reactors. But there was an interesting sidebar to this thing, which was when you talk to a lot of the people in the movement and you ask them why, and they would say the health effects, the incredible damage. Okay, it's potentially true. That is, there's potentially incredible damage from a meltdown, et cetera. And you would ask them Well, what about the damage of coal mines, which were still a very, very big deal? They are now, but they were even bigger then. What about the damage of coal mines that happens every day? It didn't cross their minds, right? It wasn't in the calculation. It just didn't register that there might be an issue there. Forget how the issue ultimately resolves. The point is it didn't arise for people, except for a relative few. And that's an example of a constituency consulting its own circumstances and not the circumstances of everybody. And it's an example of what caused, you know, we'll ask, how come there aren't more workers at our meetings? How come there aren't more workers in our organizations? Well, it's because they find us arrogant. They find us incomprehensible. They find us to be disputing things of no consequence to them. They find us to be oblivious to their circumstances, and they don't want to be around us. All right, now I'm painting it stark, but I think that stark painting has a considerable amount of truth in it. And I even think it's to a real extent justified. Now, of course, Agnew and Trump and the media aggravate it greatly by pointing to us as exactly what the working people will dislike, you know, so that's part of the problem. But so why is participatory economics a consequential vision? Well, partly because it puts the three-class thing on the map, and therefore it says to us, we have to organize in ways that take this into account. We have to have demands that take this into account. We have to have a rhetoric and a way of talking and a way of expressing ourselves that take this into account. And we have to go the places where we meet the people who have to become part of the left if the left is ever going to get any place.
Thanks very much, Michael. So I'll pass the mic around to anyone who wants it. And
I'll try.
People on Zoom can feel free to unmute themselves and ask questions.
I'll try to answer at less length, but I have this tendency of wanting to address what people ask.
Michael, thank you so much for joining us tonight. The annihilation of private property or private ownership for a collective ownership of the means of production is so entirely attractive. And you emphasize the labor process, labor, commodity market in all of that. And what's particularly salient about, I would say, 21st century economics is that which is removed from the labor process, that being commercial finance, collateralized debt obligations, investment vehicles, lending, you know, the works, just gargantuan credit. I'm wondering if these commercial ledgers have any place within the participatory framework. What, if anything, is there a role to play there?
Right. No, most things disappear. Not most things. Lots of things sort of disappear. So for instance, the owner, the private owner, just disappears. It's no longer a category that exists in a participatory economy. Of course, that takes time and takes transition, but once it's here, it's gone. Empowered jobs that are way more, they disappear. Well, we're not talking about all aspects of allocation, and there is such a thing as borrowing in a participatory economy, but no, nothing remotely like the financial sectors of the economy. And, you know, first of all, there's no earning income based on income. That's gone. There's no, look, the situation is that everybody in a participatory economy earns an income that's a function of the duration, intensity, and onerousness of their socially valued labor. So there's nobody taking from the social product a gigantic piece, because there's everybody is getting this kind of an income, and that the gap that can arise in that kind of an income is totally a function of, you know, how much more somebody can work or how much harder somebody, you know, it's not a very wide gap. None of those institutions exist then. There, it would take a while to talk about, okay, then how does long run investment get done in a participatory economy? How does, you know, how do various things happen? They all happen via the participatory planning. And those are the things that I'm not going to talk about today because it would get too, it would just, verbally, it's, you know, read the book, read, for those of you who are economists and who sort of understand economic language, so to speak, and can deal with the equations of economics, you might look up a book by Robin Hanel called Democratic Planning, because that's geared more to economists. But for non-economists, No Bosses makes the case. Anyway, the answer is gone, is the short answer. Actually, everything economic changes. You know, so anything, because why? Because the purpose of economic activity has fundamentally altered. The process of economic activity has fundamentally altered. The procedures that decide have fundamentally altered. And so pretty much everything else is going to fundamentally alter also. It's not as if everything is decided. So if this is a workplace, just to give an example, if this is a workplace, and let's say we're making bicycles, and we make a certain amount of bicycles, and the amount of bicycles we make warrants a income, duration, intensity, and onerous, the total duration, intensity, and onerousness of our efforts warrants an income. Let's call it X. Now, how do we divide X up among ourselves inside of our workplace? Well, that's for our workers' council to determine. We probably have a set of procedures that we've set up. And if you read the book, you'll see there are, you know, you can imagine different procedures that different workplaces would adopt to arrive at people getting the proper amount of remuneration. There's not one way to do everything. That was off from your question, but it's a way of conveying that I'm not going to get into details about something which doesn't really exist in remotely the same form in a participatory economy.
So my question is, can these institutions you mentioned be set up only using democratic means? Or would it postulate like a revolution? And my second question is,
I didn't fully get the first one. Can these institutions be?
Oh my God, I didn't know what I.
No, it's on. Go ahead.
Sorry. So these institutions you mentioned, can those institutions be set up only using democratic means?
Oh, I see. Yeah.
And my second question is, can this be achieved or sustained within a national framework, or would it mean? Yeah.
Okay. Let's do the second one first, because I'll remember it easier. The second question. Could you, for example, imagine striving for and attaining a participatory economy, and let's broaden it out, a participatory polity and kinship and you know, a participatory society, say in the United States, going forward, let's say the next N years? I think the answer to that is yes. But could you succeed in doing it in Honduras or Guatemala, or Scotland, or Ireland, maybe even or England, without it happening in the United States? No. Why? Because we're the mafia boss of the world. And because when countries begin to generate even far less than a participatory society, which would be, you know, total anathema for world elites, but even when economies start to do something much less than that, but threaten the power and the influence, the United States springs into action. And so there would have to be powerful forces, movements, organization to prevent that from happening. So regrettably, I think it's up to me, people in the United States, to form very powerful movements. Partly to change our own country and partly to protect other countries from our influence. And that probably applies to Russia and China too, because, although not nearly so much. But yes, you can certainly pursue a participatory economy. You can develop movements. This will get to the second question, the first part of the question also. You can certainly develop movements, begin to organize, raise consciousness, win demands moving toward a participatory economy and a participatory society. That's indeed what I think the strategy entails. It entails not being against reforms, but being against reformism. So in other words, I'm not a reformist. I don't propose that we make modest gains ameliorating pain as an end, as our goal. But I do favor making modest gains that ameliorate pain and that contribute to developing the power to make further changes as part of a process. Now, what is entailed to win? Years back in Greece, there was an event in a part of Greece that was sort of an anarchist enclave, and the police shot and killed one of the anarchist activists, and there was an explosion throughout Greece. And that was a little bit like the explosion throughout France in 1968, which came about because not somebody was shot and killed, but big universities changed their rules about what were called parietal hours. In other words, the access of men and women had to each other. And the rule change caused students to come out into the street and to demonstrate. And that ballooned into the incredible surge that was Paris in May of 68. And the events in Greece ballooned into this incredible countrywide militance and activism. And I was in Greece and I was talking to somebody who was deeply involved. And I knew that roughly 40% of the Greek population had gone into the streets. And they had additional support by people who didn't go into the streets, too old, too infirm, whatever. And I asked them, you know, what happened to, what was the next step? And they said, look, the honest answer is that the only thing we didn't do that we could have done, and we actually could have done it in many, many, many parts of the country, was to move from the street to the offices, to actually take over the government buildings. And we thought about it, they told me. And, you know, whether this is an accurate representation of all the events, I don't know. I can only convey what they conveyed. And they said, we thought about it and we realized that it would be a disaster, that we had no idea what to do, that we wouldn't be in a position to make decisions, to actually implement anything of great value. And so we didn't do it.
Apologies, Michael. I think we're having some connection issues.
Oh, sorry.
We lost you just as you were talking about the fact all they could do was storm the government building.
Well, now I didn't understand the last part of that sentence, which is, I guess, where I'm supposed to take up. What was it?
Just that the only thing left to be done was to storm government buildings.
Oh, okay. So, they said that, and I said, well, why didn't you? And they said, well, because we talked about doing it and we realized that if we occupied the buildings, we'd be sitting there like lumps on a log. We would have no idea what to do. We have no plan. We have no conception of how to change society at that nuts and bolts level. And the May of 68, this is again the violence issue. The reality is that May of 68, not that many people know this, but the NATO tanks in France were beginning to rev up. They weren't ultimately used to confront. And that's the point, that the United States will use violence, that other elites will use violence to try to prevent change in the fundamental relations, which leave them on top. So what's the answer to that? Well, some people think the answer is you fight violence with violence. I'm not against that in principle. I'm not a pacifist, but I am against it strategically. because what it does is it enters the realm where they are supreme. It fights on the terrain where they have every advantage, and you get crushed because, you know, in 1968, 69, 70, 71, there were people on the left in the United States who would go off into the countryside with their 22 rifles and shoot tin cans. And they would, some people whose names you might even know, they would cut themselves and learn how to suture it. And they were preparing for the battle to come. And they were delusional, just completely delusional, because because it was such a gigantic mismatch. So what is the answer to violence? The answer to violence is to create a condition in which the powers that be that wish to purvey violence will lose by doing so. They will lose more than they will gain. That's the answer to violence. The answer to violence is to organize sufficiently and to have sufficient support, and support that would be outraged at violence so that the violence isn't perpetrated. Because they've all of a sudden, you know, become nonviolent, the elites, but because they realize that it's not going to succeed. In the United States, when there were race riots, way back again in LA, various places, the government would call out the National Guard, but they wouldn't call out the local National Guard units. So it's not the National Guard that was closest to LA that would go into LA to deal with the LA riots. It would be the National Guard from Alabama or from Mississippi. And not just because they're South, but because those National Guard troops entering LA, it would be like entering a foreign world. They would be afraid. They would follow orders. Whereas the local National Guard might even lay down their guns. So what you have to do, and the answer to the question, I think, is that yes, the other side will want to use violence whenever violence will be effective. We have to create situations, starting now and all the way up until winning a new society in which there is no such armed force to repress us. We have to create conditions in which it is not effective. Sorry, I got a phone call and it goes straight to my hearing aid. So, so yes, there will be elements of violence. They will be minimized to the extent that we are good at creating conditions in which violence makes us stronger rather than weaker. If people are interested, I can go on with that. I mean, there are ways that you do that, for example.
Thank you very much for the talk. Was kind of wondering, there was two parts to this question, but maybe I'll remember the second one in a moment. When if it came to it that we could establish a relationship between production and consumption and reach it, this kind of participatory economy, how do we avoid falling into the trap of all becoming coordinators? That is, if we need to be constantly integrating it, a discourse between the two lines, how do we avoid absurd bureaucracy on the parts of all of us?
I don't understand the question. In a very real sense, we do all, in a good economy, want to become participants in decision-making and fully aware and capable actors in the society. Doesn't mean we're all the same by any means, of course not. But we do want to do that. So in a sense, none of us are becoming coordinators in the sense of somebody who monopolizes empowering work and does nothing disempowering. And none of us are remaining workers in the sense that we do only disempowering work. But we are all becoming, let's call it worker participants. I don't know what you want to call it. Call it workers, call it whatever. We all become actors who, to the extent we work in the economy, some don't, too young, too old, too infirm, to the extent we work in the economy, we are all similar in that regard. And I don't see the problem in that. That doesn't make us all bureaucrats, right? I don't know what that means. It makes us all participants. It makes us all decision makers, and that's as it should be, as far as I can see. Okay, I'll stretch it. We would then all be equal participants regarding human well-being, but we would all be bureaucrats regarding the well-being of nature, of animals, right? Because the spotted owl cannot participate in planning. So there's no way that the spotted owl manifests its own desires and has a say in decisions. We have to do that for the spotted owl. There's a sense in which the coordinator class in capitalism views the working population as being like spotted owls, incapable of manifesting its own preferences, incapable of taking care of itself. So the coordinator class will do that. So at its best, the coordinator class is paternalistic and arrogant. At its worst, it's much worse. But I don't think there's anything wrong with the whole population rising to the level of being a caring, capable actor in the trajectory of the economy and society.
My only worry would be that at the moment, disagreement arises. We enter into a field where we don't know how long gridlock disagreement could go on for. And so in the allegation of empowering and disempowering labor is one thing, we could all engage in that, but what third aspect of decision-making labor will start to accumulate? In that, how much time do I need to spend at planning meetings to then get to work?
Okay, I think maybe you've got two questions here. I'm not sure. One of them is, it's not that each individual, this goes back all the way to the beginning. It's not that each individual decides what is a balanced job situation for me and I'll do that, irrespective of everybody else, right? That's a kind of individual power over one's own life that goes too far. So if we're a workforce, it's not the case that each person sitting here stands in front of the mirror and consults themselves, him or herself, right, about what they want their work day to be. Rather, it's a collective decision. And so there's a collective decision about how to combine together tasks into balanced jobs. And once there's a decision about the balanced jobs, then basically people are, you know, working in one or another of them, depending on their tastes and preferences. But it's not as if, you know, everything is up to the individual to rule over. It's a collective phenomenon where you have self-managing, which is to say proportionate say. The second half of the question seems to be about time, which is a perfectly valid question to ask. If participatory economics, remember back at the beginning when I was addressing Margaret Thatcher saying that if we have balanced job complexes, we'll have no output. So sure, it's ethical. Sure, it's humane. Sure, it's nice. But we're going to sacrifice so much output that it's not worth it. And that would be a valid argument against participatory economics if it was true that participatory economics was going to sacrifice so much output that it would be debilitating for people. I not only think it won't sacrifice productivity, which is potential output, but it would enhance it. But your question is rather different. What if participatory economics, and in particular participatory planning, but you brought it down to the firm level also in the determination of what the balanced jobs are, would take so much time that it would, again, take from productivity and also just be debilitating. And these are the kinds of things that are dealt with in more detail in the book, No Bosses. But I'll use a personal story. Years back, I was part of a publishing project called South End Press that operated in this way. And actually, in some ways, it was where some of this germinated. When we got together, we realized that if somebody did the finances, they'd have a loan. They just did it, and then nobody else, they would have undue power. And if somebody, you know, worked always with the best author, the biggest author, say Chomsky, they'd have, in case of Southland Press, they would have undue power. And so we had to figure out how to allot tasks to people in such a way that when we came to meetings, it wouldn't be dominated by one person or two people. And that was the beginning of the balanced job complex idea. But it wasn't, it was a collective thing, and it happened. We did it once a year at one meeting in a retreat. So it wasn't an undue burden. And as to planning not being an undue burden there, I think you either take my word for it, or you read the book No Bosses, or one of the other ones that exists about participatory economics, and you decide for yourself. But there's all sorts of ways in which the time allotment of people is cut drastically in participatory economics. Not only don't we produce all that military stuff, so not only do we get rid of all kinds of idiotic production and waste production, and not only do we get rid of the class warfare and therefore all the time that goes into that, but our capacities are freed up, and so the productivity is greater. So my estimate would be that in a participatory economy, now I'm guessing, I would guess that the population would opt for not a 40-hour week, not a 35-hour week, probably a 30-hour week. And it would probably be 30 hours in part because people like and are fulfilled at work, not just for the output. Planning would occur again during 1 week and so on. I don't want to minimize the question. I don't want to minimize the question. It's a valid question. And if it can't be answered, if it takes too long to do participatory economics, then participatory economics doesn't work. But I think the answer is it not only doesn't take too long, it frees up lots of time for people to lead much richer lives.
Certainly hope so.
So my question is that certainly establishing the conditions under which this participatory economics can be established, I mean, raising class consciousness, organizing the people or letting them organize and like movements, etc. This is not a short-term goal. Like it will take like long time, well, not long time, but my question is, we are amidst a climate crisis, and do we run out of time sooner than for the conditions to all just add up and for us to lead this kind of participatory economics?
Yes, the answer is yes in the following sense. There are many people who say you can't deal with global warming and various other ecological issues, but let's stick to global warming for the moment. You can't deal with global warming unless you replace capitalism. And they're wrong. If that was true, you might as well go to the beach between now and when it all unravels. It is necessary to deal with global warming while capitalism still exists. And it is not impossible. Trees won't fly, and capitalist firms won't, of their own free will, forego profit. But that doesn't mean that you can't put pressure on them before you have totally transformed them to do things that they wouldn't ordinarily do. In fact, almost everything that we have you know, the work week, the rate of pay that people get. None of it is what capitalists would optimally prefer. It is a product of having struggled for it. And it is possible to struggle as well for, you know, green results, for reduced waste production, for reduced military budgets, and so on and so forth, dealing with global warming. But I want to answer a little more broadly than that. You're right, absolutely. I mean, I don't know when participatory economy will be a, you know, a viable working system in one or many economies. I don't know the answer to that, of course. Nobody could possibly know the answer to that. But I don't think it's, you know, a millennia away. I don't think it's anything like that. It depends on us. But in the short run, the implications of it being a vision that we share, if we did, so if we were to share participatory economics and if movements were to share participatory economic vision, what difference would it make? Well, it would mean that when arguing for, let's say, a higher minimum wage, we would also talk about what equitable remuneration really is. And we would be organizing the struggle for the higher minimum wage in a way that would lead to not going home having won it, but continuing to fight for getting closer and closer to and ultimately winning equitable remuneration. And when we organize in workplaces, we might begin to organize workers' councils. And those workers' councils then might take up issues of work organization and make demands around that. And we can go on and on through the various domains in which we could make demands, including investment, including, say, the military budget, and so on and so forth. But there's one other part of this that I want to address. Why do elites give in? How does radical dissent and demonstrating and activism win anything? I mean, why does it win? When does it win? Imagine you're fighting for a street light at a corner in your neighborhood because it's a dangerous corner and there's been too many accidents. And so, you know, a couple of residents go out and picket and hold a demonstration, and then more people join them and so on. Well, is it winnable? Can you win it? And if you can win it, why would you win? And the answer is, in an overwhelming number of cases, it's not because you change the minds of the decision maker. It's because you create a situation of costs, because the decision maker is under all sorts of pressures. It's because you create a set of costs that cause the decision maker to feel putting in the stoplight is better than this kind of demonstration continuing to build. This kind of demonstration is starting to threaten things that I care about much more, now the powers that be, that I care about much more than I care about not putting in the stoplight. So I'll put in the damn stoplight to stop the process that is more threatening. Now switch it to a war, right? Why does opposition to the war begin to have an impact or have an impact or even win? It's the exact same thing. The purveyors of the war, the decision makers that are enacting the war, so to speak, they have an agenda. It might be different in different cases. In the case of the United States, it's usually to stop the spread of a good example, but it could be something else. But they have an agenda. We create a movement. If we, for example, turn out 100,000 people in Washington, January 1st, February 1st, March 1st. We just keep turning out 100,000 people. Ultimately, it's worthless. Why? Because if it doesn't grow, it involves no threat at all. All they have to do is clean up after the 100,000 people and go home. They don't care. But if we have 20,000, and then we have 40,000, and then we have 60,000, this starts to look very threatening. And if we move from a demand to end the war to a demand to end the war and cut the military budget, which has many purposes other than war, like, well, leave that for the moment, and end the war and redistribute wealth and power, Now what's happening is we're directly threatening the thing that they're pursuing the war to protect. And if our threat begins to grow great enough, they're going to start to see that, well, yeah, I think I'll pass on the war. I'll try and back out of that because what it's producing is more dangerous to me. Same thing with climate. So global warming, why are they reticent to do anything about it? Partly because they don't like giving in on anything because it establishes the idea that you can win things and make changes, and they don't like that. That's very dangerous. That's threatening. Partly because it would interfere with profits and power to really deal with global warming. So we go out and we create a movement against global warming. And we put 100,000, it's the same or exact argument. If we are a stable movement, if we don't threaten their interests in a way that is that disturbs them more than giving in on global warming, we don't win. But what disturbs them more? Well, it's partly the power that we can manifest and keep growing, but it's also the focus of the scope of what we're saying. If the global warming, if fighting global warming is radicalizing everybody, is causing everybody to have consciousness and commitments that are going to go right on and that are going to threaten all of their institutions, that's much more dangerous than if it's totally confined. So my answer is that, yes, we have to win the global warming battle very likely before we have a new economy. I, you know, part of me hopes that we could have a new economy in 10 years or 15 years, and I'd get to see it, and great. And then we would have no global warming problem because we would quickly deal with it. But I don't think that's too likely. And in the absence of that, we have to deal with global warming while capitalism is in the saddle. But doing so will be enhanced by not only building movements for global warming, but by the trade union activism that's going on now in the United States and the strikes that are going on, even if they don't mention global warming, right? If there's a process that's unfolding in a manner that is threatening elite power, then they want to somehow cause that process to dissipate back. And so basically, all kinds of organizing and demonstrating and activism are of value insofar as they interlink and insofar as they tend to have a mindset, not everybody will, but they tend to have a mindset that we're fighting for this now, but it's not because that's the end. It's as part of a process where we keep on fighting. And we win more and more until we get a new society. And so I think the vision is very relevant even to global warming and even to winning global warming under capitalism. This would be my answer. I should say, if I didn't think that, I wouldn't be working on it, right? I would be working on global warming per se. And I know a number of people have told me, look, Michael, I think it's great, but I don't want to do anything about it because I want to focus on global warming. And that's okay too, you know. But I think if all those global warming activism was tied to an economic vision, a post-capitalist vision, a post-patriarchal vision, and so on, it would be immeasurably more powerful and more effective at dealing with global warming.
Hi, Michael. Thanks very much for the talk. I just wanted to quickly ask about your opinions on Mondragon, the kind of famous worker cooperative in Spain. I think it's worker-owned, but manager-controlled. And in recent years, they've kind of been accused of increasing bureaucracy. And maybe kind of because they're working within capitalist market economy, they're kind of they have negative externalities are taking place. But I was just thinking that because there's increasing bureaucracy, I think, between managers and workers, and there's less kind of worker direct worker participation That seems to hit at the heart of what you're saying about how the left is kind of, even though Mondragon tackles the problem between workers and owners, that it misses the professional classes and the managers. And yeah. I just wanted to hear your take on that. Thank you.
Yeah, the coordinator class. See, I wouldn't call it bureaucracy. I would call it, you know, coordinator class dominance. But that's maybe quibbling. Let me tell you a story first about Argentina and then Mondragon, because this so exemplifies the same issues. I was there about 20 years ago, roughly, almost exactly, I think. And Argentina had undergone an economic crisis, the country as a whole, in which many firms were failing. They were not generating profits, they were generating losses. And many of the capitalists decided to punt, to leave them. They were in such bad shape. And then as the capitalists left, the managers and the engineers and the lawyers and so on, the coordinator class left with them, because the coordinator class sort of felt like, well, this place is already failing. The capitalist is gone. I got to go someplace else to make my, you know, my income. But the workers were left. And so the workers took over these firms, a great many of them in Argentina. And I was at an event, I was speaking at various things, and this was an event that was put together. There were about, oh, roughly, I can't remember exactly, let's say 30 to 50, but there, a considerable number of people who were there from occupied factories. Now, these factories were occupied and they were working. They had been failing and now they were succeeding. So that's interesting right there. And the whole coordinator class had left. So that's interesting. So to start this session with these folks, I say, let's go around the room a little bit and hear from you. They were very animated and lively at the beginning. After all, they were meeting people from throughout the country who were in circumstances similar to theirs. But we went around the room and it was the seventh person. I tell this story often, and it's always the seventh person because it was the seventh person. The seventh person, the level of sort of animation and energy and excitement and joy in the room has depleted, and now it's pretty maudlin. And the seventh person says, I never thought I would say anything like this. And he was sort of reiterating what others had said in different ways. But maybe Margaret Thatcher was right. Maybe there is no alternative. We took over our workplace. We instituted, he didn't use the word equitable, but we instituted equitable incomes. Basically, they equalized the incomes and then made small differentiations. We set up a workers' council. We instituted democracy. And some of them even instituted something closer to self-management at the outset. But now it's 6 months later, and all the old crap is coming back. And the alienation is coming back, and the indignities are coming back, and maybe she was right. And that was the general sentiment going around, and these were the people who had done this. And so I asked them, I said, when you took over, and the owners were gone, and the professionals, the managers, the coordinator class was gone, what did you do about those tasks, those jobs? And they didn't understand the question at first, because to them it was sort of like asking, what'd you do about lunch? Well, you eat it. That is to say, it was straightforward. Somebody had to do that job. And that's what they did. They had somebody be the financial officer, and they had somebody be the various jobs that existed in their respective workplaces that were empowering. And I said to them, and you think that all the old crap is coming back because of human nature, because it's somehow built into the human genetic code that working together involves this kind of indignity, this kind of some above others and rule and so on. They said, yeah. And I said, well, I don't think so. I think what it was that you kept the old corporate division of labor, and that despite all those terrific changes that you made, the old corporate division of labor slowly but surely is undoing them. Because the people who took those jobs, the empowered ones, start to see themselves as more necessary, because they are more necessary in the new arrangement. And they start to see themselves as more knowledgeable because they are in the new arrangement. And over time, you have the emergence of this class division. The second half of, the second half of this issue was I'm sitting and talking to a woman who has become the chief financial officer of a glass factory. And I first I ask her what she was doing before. She takes me to this furnace where she was, you know, staffing the furnace, so to speak. I couldn't even stand standing there. She would do it all day long, day in, day out, day in, day out. Okay, that's working class disempowered work. Now she was the chief financial officer of the firm. And I said to her, what was the hardest thing to learn? I mean, after all, this is ridiculous. You're from a working class background. You had virtually insignificant training and you were doing that job. And now you have to do the finances and do the books. What was the hardest thing? She didn't want to answer. So I said, well, was it learning accounting concepts? No. Was it learning how to use the computer? No. Was it learning how to do spreadsheets? No. Well, I don't know. Was it making reports and conveying the information? And no. I said, look, I give up, but I really want to know and understand what was the hardest thing for you to learn? And she said, first I had to learn to read. So she went from being working class and basically largely illiterate to taking the place of the august, highly status, you know, accountant, financial officer in a few months. So Thatcher's notion, and nobody should have to do that, but she did it. No, Thatcher's notion that under no circumstances can working people do empowering work disappears. It's just nonsense. It is not true. It is a prejudice just as bad as the prejudice that, you know, blacks can only throw a ball or women can only nurture a kid or whatever, right? It's just that bad. And I succeeded in forgetting the question because I got so wrapped up in the answer. But in any case, that's the kind of insight that we need in order to have a movement that speaks to all the relevant constituencies, which is not only blacks or other racially oppressed constituencies, and it's not only women or trans people or other sexually and kinship oppressed constituencies, but it's also working people. And we also need to learn how to talk to coordinator class people in a way that can reach past their prejudices and biases and talk to their human sentiments. Because it's not as if we want them all to line up on the other side. We don't. They're not the enemy. They have to be incorporated also. But the key lesson is we don't cater our manner, our style, our language, our demands to attracting coordinator class people. We orient all that to reaching working people. And then we have some additional stuff that we do to try and overcome the resistance of coordinator class people. And all that is strategic insights that I think would be very valuable for movements now. Oh, wait, I know, Mondragon. Okay, so I went on that bypass because it's the same thing. Mondragon didn't go nearly as far as that glass factory went in some respects, but in other respects, it's very similar. And so Mondragon has made changes that are, you know, Mondragon compared to a capitalist firm under a capitalist owner is you'd rather work at Mondragon, given the choice, or at least I think you would, I would. But is it a participatory economic firm? No, it's not. And it's because of its division of labor. And as the as was described in the question, that division of labor over time not only isn't as good as what you want it to be, but gets worse, because the coordinator class part of the workforce becomes more and more enamored of its own qualities and more to believe that it deserves more income and that the working part deserves less. I'll tell you one last. If you ask an honest manager or owner why they pay so little to workers, right, in a situation where they do, I think the answer, if they were being truly honest about their sentiment, not the truth of the situation, which is the institutions force it, but about their sentiment, would be something like this, that would be very self-serving. Look, I could give them more, but what would they do with it, right? They just don't have the culture. They don't have the wherewithal. They don't have the capacity. They would misuse it. So I'm doing them a favor. They'd get in trouble with it. If I gave them more, they'd get in trouble. So I'm looking out for them by paying them minimum wage or sub-minimum wage. It may sound familiar from the way slave owners talked about slaves and caring about them and keeping them from, that's the paternalism that I'm talking about. But that paternalism rests on a degree of delusional elitism and delusional self-worth that makes it, you know, not like the honest paternalism of a father or mother for a three-year-old. It's not like that.
I was just wondering if you could elaborate on earlier when you were talking about that we have to create a situation where it would be detrimental or harmful to the government to apply the use of violence, what that would entail.
Sure. Well, let me give one personal example. First, I went to school in Cambridge a long time ago, and we had big movements, turning schools inside out, very active, et cetera, et cetera. This is in 1968, 69, 70, 71. And at a certain point in time, the administration and the city police and bureaucracy issued a injunction preventing various of us by name from being on campus. I was at MIT. Now, if it had been Texas and we had done what we did, we would have wound up in jail or worse. But it was Massachusetts, and we had considerable support beyond the border of the school. And so I got up on the steps at the outset of the school and gave a fiery speech and held up the injunction and ripped it up right in front of the cameras and right in front of the police. And they couldn't do anything. Why couldn't they do anything? It wasn't that I was so courageous or anything like that. It was that we had a pretty smart movement. And we had a situation where we knew damn well that if they marched up those steps and grabbed me, first of all, that would have been a melee. But if they had done that, they would have lost support. They wouldn't have gained support. And they wouldn't have made the campus less radical. They would have made it more radical. And so the sort of repressive activity that they had at their disposal could not be employed. We then, later we had demonstrations against what were called the iLabs, the instrumentation labs. These were labs at MIT that were, you know, doing technical stuff. The technical stuff that they were doing at the time, which we had to break into them to find out, but we found out, was they were developing MIRV, M-I-R-V, multiple independent reentry vehicles. It was basically a way to have nuclear weapons atop of a missile and have bunches of nuclear weapons delivered by the one missile and go off and hit targets further away. So it was a first strike weapon. And we were opposed to that. And we were actually even more opposed, because we didn't think that would ever actually be used, to something that they said they called it helicopter stabilization. And they said it was for inner city helicopters in order to fly over traffic and be stable. That was what they said. We had our doubts, broke in, saw that they were gunships of the sort used in Vietnam. And what they were doing was trying to stabilize the helicopters so that the machine gunning from the helicopters could hit its target. And what was its target? Well, a famous phrase from the time was anything that flies on anything that moves. That was the United States approach to Indochina. Get everything we can into the air that can shoot, and then shoot anything that moves. And this program at one of the most august higher education institutions in the world was to stabilize those gunships so that they would be more effective at killing anything that moves. And when we did our demonstrations, they called out the National Guard. They had troops on the top of buildings with rifles and bayonets and all. It was a gigantic show of force designed to prevent the demonstration out of fear. We ignored it. Was it because we were so courageous? No, it's because we knew that they couldn't do anything. All they could do was the kind of thing that was being done. All of that high power capability would fade into the background, and we would be at most fighting with police in the street in the usual 60s fashion. And that was because of the support that existed. It's just like, it's the difference between if you have a strike at a company in a town and you do new organizing in the town and you're isolated, then the use of scabs will be easier and the use of police to beat you down will be easier. But if you organize in the town as well and you have a growing circle of support, and if you can have people in other firms of the same sort who are paying attention, you can create a situation in which it's much harder to use violence to repress you. And that's the kind of thing that you do in all those cases. And what you can't do is say, oh, who gives a damn? They've got the army. Let's go fight the army. You know, let's go fight the... That is a losing battle. That is not the way to win. And not only is it a losing battle, but it will also cause you to become your own worst enemy, because it will cause you to become totally mired in trying to figure out how to, you know, how to be violent, how to fight violence, and it will fracture the movement and so on. So the arguments for nonviolence, and I don't even use those all the time. If I'm part of a picket line, say, and scabs are trying to cross it, that's a situation where I think violence can make sense and be effective. That is, protecting the people on the line and keeping the people out of the firm. Okay, so sometimes violence makes sense. Sometimes violence against property certainly makes sense. But violence that incurs greater violence and then escalates doesn't make sense. One way we used to say this is, if you lie down on the train tracks by yourself, they'll run you over, and they will. So that's not the solution. If you lie down on train cracks with 10,000 people, that's a different situation. And so it's organizing that matters the most, not going off into the countryside and shooting your 22 at a tin can and thinking that you're a revolutionary.
Michael, I think we're coming to the end of the questions in the room. So generally the setup for these things is that we all get together and have a drink after and have a chat about what went on for the night. Unfortunately, you won't be able to join us. I know you would if you were able to attend. I imagine one of the things that's going to come up is, what can we in Ireland do? Because you said before, the change, if it's going to happen in terms of establishing a participatory society, has to happen in the States or China or Russia. Well, I'm wondering, what do you think we can do?
Yeah, no, I don't want to go that far. The reason why did the United States do Vietnam? When I was first learning about it, everybody was running around saying it's because of the resources in Vietnam, it's economics, etc. So I tried to look into it and see, well, what the hell are the resources that they're talking about? And I found that Vietnam was rich in tungsten, and tungsten was used in the planes that we would fly over Vietnam to bomb Vietnam. So ostensibly, we're bombing Vietnam into the Stone Age in order to get the tungsten to bomb Vietnam into the Stone Age. I was not convinced. Then later, a different formulation arose. And Chomsky was one of the main purveyors, probably the originator of the phrase also, the threat of a good example. And here is a very different notion. The notion is the problem with Vietnam isn't Vietnam per se, right? If a comet came down and hit Vietnam and leveled the whole country, as disgusting as that would be, the next day the United States would have just continued on. Right? It's not as if Vietnam or Indochina was crucial to the maintenance of economic dynamics in the United States. That's nonsense. But the threat was that you could extricate yourself from the American empire, and that others might see that, and that others might emulate that. And you couldn't allow that. It's sort of why, and this is an analogy that is not far-fetched, it's why the mafia, you know, the criminal, organized criminal elements would respond so violently to any break in discipline. It wasn't because they needed the breaker of discipline to be punished. That wasn't the point. The point was to show everybody else, you don't mess with us. You don't screw around with us. And that's what American foreign policy is overwhelmingly about, saying, look, it's our world, we do what we want, and don't mess with us. And so messing with them is constructive. Stuff that goes on in Vietnam or in Ireland or in any place else that is a process that's unfolding and that recognizes the danger of American intervention, but also keeps traveling down the road, is saying to us in the United States and in Russia and China and in Germany and so on and so forth, look at what we're doing. You can do it too. So that's the threat of a good example. So when I say that it's hard for a country that is subject to external violence to attain the ultimate goal short of that violence being curbed, I think that's true. But it's also true that when that country that would be subject to that external violence pursues a positive course and offers a positive model, that's incredibly valuable. A part of the whole process. So what you can do in Ireland is what anybody can do anywhere. You can organize to raise consciousness. You can fight for reforms in a way that is oriented toward fighting for more reforms when you win. You can develop movements which are sensitive to race, gender, power, but also class, meaning the three classes, not just the two classes. You could begin to create workers' councils, you could begin to create consumers' councils, you could begin to make demands, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And if you arouse the displeasure of the United States, that's my fault. I mean movements throughout the United States, if we're not strong enough to withstand it. But if you move, it will help us and it will help yourselves.
I think that's a perfect note to end proceedings on. I'd like to thank you again. I'd like to thank Meta and Satiris. Before we finish, is there anything else you'd like to say, Michael?
Only that when you go out and you have your drink and Sotiris and I have to stay here and not enjoy it. If you have questions and you raise questions and you raise concerns, and Sam's going to be there, I'd be happy to field them in email. So any of you should feel free to send email, concerns, extensions, alternatives, whatever you like. to me at SysOp, S-Y-S-O-P, at zmag.org. And also, you might look into realutopia.com, which I mentioned, which is a whole vehicle for exploring these kinds of ideas, and also these kinds of ideas about family life and gender and schooling and sexuality and culture and politics and so on, things that we didn't really talk about.